over to you, Pat.
Thank you very much. Well, I've actually put this down a little bit as the beginning because my background is very much as in teaching, not research. So if anybody thinks they're going to hear a webinar about mathematical research, I'm afraid you're in the wrong forum at the moment. I've had 30 years teaching in state education, teaching primary all the way from year reception through to year six. And then having got as far as headship, I decided that I would like a change. So I then went and did my postgraduate diploma in dyslexia with Dyslexia Action when they were Dyslexia Institute. And then I discovered that dyslexics actually have a problem with maths. So I ended back with my original thing because I'd always been a maths coordinator throughout my career. I ended up back with my love of maths and here I am with my work on dyslexia and maths. So the aim today is about practical tips, not theoretical ideas. Having been in the classroom with lots of pupils, sometimes I found that the same kinds of things keep recurring and I found different things that work. But I will promise you that this is not an endless list and they don't work for everybody. So I'm sorry, I'm not the oracle in that respect. Today I would like to look at why dyslexia might affect maths learning. And then is it the same as dyscalculia? Because we have this word keeps coming up these days. We hear a lot about dyscalculia. Then what can we do to help? Looking at various math topics and practical tips, and then rounding it all up, and at the end, any questions which you've already been told about how you can send those in. So first of all, why should dyslexia affect maths learning? Well, surprisingly, maths is a language. It has symbols for letters, it has sentences, for instance 4 plus 3 equals 7, it has shorthand, we have pluses and multiplication signs, and we have our own use of words. Unfortunately, those words are often the same kind of words that we might use in everyday life. So when I'm talking about a plane shape in maths, I'm not talking about an aeroplane zipping around in the airport. And equally, if I'm talking about taking away, I'm not talking about the local Chinese. I'm talking about subtraction. Unfortunately, some pupils don't actually understand the difference between these words. Working memory, which we know for dyslexics is weak, is really important in maths. It's virtually impossible to do any kind of mental calculation unless you're using your working memory. And unfortunately, with very little working memory, sometimes people find it extremely difficult to do all sorts of mental calculation. Times tables is one of the things that's particularly difficult, and there are some strategies for overcoming this, but we'll come to those later. Sequencing. If you have a good working memory or a good working memory shelf, then you can actually look at long sequences and you can actually see all the numbers. If you actually have a very short working memory, a short shelf, then you might not hold all the numbers. So if your sequence was 2, 4, 8, which is obviously an arithmetical multiplication one, then you would know the next number was 16. But if it's 2, 4, 6, then the next number would be 8. If you can only hold the first two numbers in your memory, then the kind of sequence you get could be quite arbitrary. Word retrieval is quite difficult for most people with dyslexia, and so you get sort of language difficulty. I know I often have my pupils who, when we're talking about obtuse angles, suddenly talk about obese angles, because obese seems to be more in their vocabulary. And instead of acute angles, I get cute ones. Fortunately, I can make them see how the words might coincide. But what do you do with the words like tetrahedron and parallel, which are extremely difficult to remember or even to say for some dyslexics? And remembering procedures. They can be quite long, particularly long multiplication and long division. And often people with dyslexia actually have quite good numerical understanding, but they can't remember where they are in the procedure and can't remember the whole procedure. And so they actually fail when it comes to doing those operations. and then direction. Dyslexic pupils often have enough trouble reading and writing going just from left to right. But of course in maths we don't just go from left to right, we also go from right to left and sometimes up and sometimes down. And so they often don't know which direction they're going in. So you can see how all this can really affect their maths learning. Is it the same as dyscalculia? Well, that would be quite difficult to decide because at the moment there's still no agreed definition for dyscalculia. If you're following what the DFVS might say, then any child who has a number difficulty of any kind could be classed as dyscalculic. But if you actually look at the researchers, they are thinking about something much more akin to dyslexia but with numbers involved. And that then becomes a neurological problem, which is quite different. So if I've said that a child had a reading problem, we would not assume they necessarily had dyslexia. And so if a child has a number problem, it does not necessarily mean it will likely be dyscalculia. And I think some of the children that I see have a difficulty not with dyscalculia, but with their dyslexia instead. It's very difficult to actually test for dyscalculia because there aren't any tests. There are screeners, but they can only say that somebody is predisposed to dyscalculia. There are no tests that can actually say this pupil definitely has it. So that can be a difficulty at the moment. And then, is the difficulty mathematical or procedural? I have a pupil quite recently that I worked with only for a very few weeks. He was very dyslexic and somebody had asked him to come to see me because they thought he might be dyscalculic. When I actually get to talk to him and look at his maths, his mathematical ability was quite astounding. If he was asked to work out the profit or loss on a percentage, say something was £50 and it was 10% off its sale, he could actually work out the percentage but then couldn't subtract it because he actually had procedures wrong for addition, subtraction and multiplication. He was always starting from the wrong side. Once that was corrected, he actually became an A-star pupil. So people can be very mistaken about what the problem actually is. So what can be done to help? Well, practical apparatus, I think, is the key for most dyslexic pupils. We seem to stop at roundabout reception, year one, but once we get to year two and above, we don't seem to want to use practical apparatus. And I really don't understand why not. I think that would help a great deal for most dyslexic pupils. Slower pace would help. We always seem to be in a hurry with maths. I don't know why. I think understanding is far more important than actually racing ahead, learning a procedure by rote. And most dyslexic pupils need to have that understanding and will find their own route through. Smaller steps. Sometimes there are actually smaller steps than we can even imagine. So actually watching how a pupil works and trying to fit in things where they actually have a problem can be really important. More repetition. If you think of a dyslexic pupil, they often work very slowly. So if a dyslexic pupil, say, needs 16 repeats to actually understand something, they might actually, in one session, only do four, and so they will need four sessions to do it. Another pupil might actually only need eight sections to do something, and might do that all in one session. You see how a dyslexic pupil would need a lot longer to actually repeat something before they've got it into their memory, more than other pupils. And unfortunately, the national curriculum tends to rotate through their spiral curriculum quite quickly. And unfortunately, by the time something is coming around again, the dyslexic pupil can't remember how it's done and isn't sure about it at all, and so doesn't even gain from the next one, has to go back to square one again. More frequent revision. When it's in their memory, they very easily lose it. I have to say they have a very poor filing system. If they do not retrieve it often, then they can't find where it is in their memory, and so it gets lost forever. So if it's brought back regularly, then there's a very good chance that they will remember what to do. Topics and practical tips. This is what I'm hoping we can do. We're going to look at topics individually, identify practical strategies that have worked for me. Now, I'm not claiming these will work for everybody, and they often have to be tailored to individuals. So even if I've got something that works regularly, it often has to be tweaked for an individual pupil. So I'm going to look at counting first, because if you can't count, how do you know where numbers are placed? I think counting is very underrated. In a group, you can't easily identify what people are saying. So it's very easy to think that people are counting when they're really not. I've put a sequence here, 9, 10, 11, 12, 21, 22, because for some reason 12 and 20 are often mistaken in my dyslexic pupils. And so they say 9, 10, 11, 12, think they said 20, and immediately go to 21 and 22. And this is nothing to do with 12 looking like 21. It's just the way it sounds more than anything else. Equally, I can get the sequence 10, 11, 12, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 20. Because in actual fact, they think those teen numbers are actually teen numbers and they don't hear the difference. So they are thoroughly confused about what these numbers actually mean. And if they think that 30 and 13 are the same number, you can see how there can be real confusion with counting. And you need to be able to count forward and backwards. I start most of my sessions with a counting session. We start with different numbers and we'll count on in ones or we'll count on in tens. When you say counting on in tens, then you regularly count 10, 20, 30, 40. But how many count 1, 11, 21, 31, which is still counting in tens? And really helps them understand how the system works. They also then need to go backwards because that's really important for a sequence for subtraction. So I've looked at addition and subtraction as my next things. Practical apparatus. Again, this seems to stop very early on, but some pupils need an apparatus right through to year 5, year 6. I remember one pupil, even at year 6, who would sit with cubes on the edge of the table. They never really needed them, but it was a long time before they were confident enough to have those removed. And I used to say, the box has been there, but we've not opened it for a few weeks. Can we put it away? And eventually they felt they could get rid of it. But it was they needed it like a comfort blanket for quite a while. Like number bonds to 10. Are really important. Often mine use jigsaws, they fit the pieces together like a jigsaw, and often I'll get a dice, we'll just roll a dice through it several times, make a list of numbers, and then we'll try matching the bonds together. So if I've got 6, 4, 3, 5, 2, we will look at 6 and 4 together. And then we'll see that 3 and 2 would make 5, and I could add those to 5, and just do those as a string of numbers. So it's important that those bonds are really well learnt, and it needs lots of practice. It doesn't happen quickly with people with dyslexia. Once you've got the number bonds to 10, then you need to teach the number bonds to 20. And one of the things I have learnt is that just because they know number bonds to 10, you can't assume that they know their number bonds to 20. They physically need to know that 13 plus 7 is 10 plus 3 plus 7, and that 10 is 1, 10, and 3 and 7 makes another 10, and see how those numbers are made up, because they actually won't just relate them across. And similarly with numbers to 100, where they need to see that there are 10 tens, and then you could do 4 tens and 6 tens make 100. And then I always try to use the opposite operation to check an answer. If they just do the same procedure, they are likely to make a similar error. If they actually can do the opposite operation, then they're like, unless they get back to their original answer, they know they've made a mistake and can check again. And equally, it means that they have, in one session, practice with addition and subtraction at the same time. Here's some of the practical apparatus that I use. It can be very inexpensive, like just a set of straws, or you can have the Dean's apparatus. Cuisenaire, which is the coloured ones in the corner, are really good for number bonds because you can see how the pattern of number bonds work. And then we have a Slavonic abacus, which is, unlike a normal abacus, has the two colours. And you can see there that if I have, say, in the fourth row there, you can see that I've got 7 and 3. I can see that 5 and 2 make 7 and that 3. So it becomes very easy to count. And I can actually see quite clearly that I've got 37 on one side and I've got 63 on the other without really lots of counting. So Slavonic abacus is really a very nice tool to use for these kind of things. When it comes to recording addition, I find base 10 quite useful. And if you look at this, you can see that I've used 28 plus 15. And by combining the 8 and 5, I've actually bridged the 10. I've had to move a 10 over to the other side, and then I've only got 3 left in the unit column. This sort of explains why there's suddenly a 1, an extra 1 in the tens column, because it's there. You can see where it's come from, and it's not a surprise, and it's not any kind of trick. Similarly, when you're actually recording subtraction, you can actually show that one of the tens has had to be changed into ones and has been moved onto the unit side. So you can actually see that a 10 has moved onto the other side, and it becomes clear why we're crossing numbers out, and it becomes clear why we're moving ones across. So there's not some, I've forgotten what I'm crossing out, and I've forgotten where I'm putting a 1. They know why they're doing it and where it goes. Multiplication and division really are not a mystery. After all, multiplication and division are just repeated addition and subtraction. So if you can add and subtract, you should be able to multiply and divide. There are different formats, and these need to be shown to be the same. Often people say, I can do division, but I'm not sure about this bus stop division. Well, in actual fact, they're not doing anything different. They're just putting things in a different place. Learning multiplication tables is a real chore for people with dyslexia. And some of them can learn them, and if they can, then they should be encouraged to. But some of them find it hard or impossible to learn. But there is a solution. You can use a multiplication square. And not just a multiplication square that is there shown for you, but a multiplication square that they actually generate for themselves. I have found that this has to be taught to precision, and all my pupils might take 15-20 minutes starting out trying to write it, but at the end they can all do it in about 3.5 minutes, and they can use it for a variety of different reasons. I found that even for GCSE pupils, to be able to write a multiplication square before they go into an exam can solve a lot of problems for them. They say that going into the exam, all they need is a request that they have a piece of square paper left in the exam room for them, which is usually able to be complied with, and then they, at the beginning of the exam, as soon as they're given the time to start, they'll write their own multiplication square and then use it throughout their test. And GCSE students have said to me that really it makes such a difference because they can actually write it, then they know they've got all their tables there and they can relax and they can actually move on and get on with their test from then on. So let's look at repeated addition. 3 plus 3 plus 3 plus 3 equals 12, which is then abbreviated to 4 times 3 equals 12. 4 times x equals 12. I'm branching into algebra here. Now the X is, the multiplication sign, is removed in algebra because it gets confused with an X. So we get 4X equals 12. Now, once they know that this only sign that's removed in algebra is the time sign, and if they see a number next to a letter, then they should always assume that there's going to be a multiplication sign between, then this becomes clear and algebra becomes less threatening. Here's another one, 4 plus 4 plus 4 equals 12. We tell them these are the same. Not quite, but I tell them that the answers are the same, and that's what's important. And you can see then that it comes up with a different algebraic answer. Here are the different formats. 4 times 3 equals 12 written horizontally, and 4 times 3 equals 12 written vertically. I find that pupils now, well into key stage 2, actually still do horizontal arithmetic, and actually dyslexic pupils are much better doing horizontal arithmetic, and so we'll find it easier. 12 divided by 3, they get used to seeing like the top, but when they're shown the bottom one, they don't realise it's the same. And what you have to realise, of course, is that the denominator has moved. You divide by 3, and you've moved it, the divisor has moved over to the other side, and that can confuse pupils greatly. Direction is one of the things that really does have a difficulty. Right. Now this multiplication square that we are going to see how it works. It's quite important that they do this often, and there is the same formulaic way of doing it, and actually there's no multiplication involved at all. So if you have your square and you write 1 to 10 across the top, and you write 1 to 10 down the side, and then on from the 10 you count in tens down to 100, and then you do the same across the bottom, so you've got the outer rim of your multiplication square. Then you need to put in your twos. So most children can count in twos, even dyslexic pupils. So they can count their 2, 4, 6, 8 and so on. I used to say, just be careful that you've already got 2 there, you're going to write 4 next and so on. And it doesn't matter whether they go across or down, they can choose which direction suits them. Some go in one direction, some go in another, and you'll find that they'll stick to that. And then we do fives next. 5, 10, 15, 20, most of them can count in fives as well, so they can just write as it, and this divides it up quite nicely. Then we do the nines. Now the nines got a lovely pattern. So if you look at 1, you start with 1, and you write 2, 3, 4 is written, 5, 6, 7, 8, then you go next to 8 and write 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is written, 6, 7. And you do the same across the bottom. So the 9 creates a very nice pattern there. Then we have to look at the 3s. Now, there are lots of different ways of doing the 3s. If you've got 3, 6, you could add 3 on and get 9 and 12, 15 is already there. Add another 3, 18, 21, 24. Or if you're really stuck, you can look at 3 and 6 that you've already written and just add them together to get 9. 4 and 8, add them together to get 12. 5 and 10, 15 is already there. 6 and 12, 18, and so on. When you come to 4s, 4, 8, 12, we add on 4 for 16. You've got 20. Add on 4 for 24, 4 for 28, 4 for 32. But also, what some of my pupils find really useful is there is a digit pattern there, 48260 in the unit column, and that repeats 48260 in the unit column. So some of them will actually go back and look at those earlier numbers. They'll get to 20 without any bother and use the earlier numbers to help them write those ones in the lower numbers. And it doesn't matter whether you go across or down, you need to put both in. So all we've got missing now is this little box of 9. From 30, we just need to add 6 to get 36, another 6 to add 42, another 6 to add 48. And again, if you have a look, you've got a 6, 2, 8, 4, 0 pattern. It repeats another 6, 2, 840 pattern. And when it comes to 7, 7 sevens are 49. Mine learn a little rhyme. Wakey, wakey, rise and shine, 7 sevens are 49, which they quite like. And 56, well, apart from just adding on another 7, if you actually reverse it and put the answer first, so you do 56 equals 7 times 8, then you've got a nice pattern of 5, 6, 7, 8 to help them remember which way around it goes. Last of all, we've got 64, and again, they have another rhyme that the boys love. I ate and I ate, and I was sick on the floor, 8 eights are 64, which they really enjoy. So they put that in, and that presents no problems to them. Now, the other things you've got is there are patterns like 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, quite easy for the even numbers, but not many people realise that 3 also has a pattern. If you look at the digits for 3, if you add the digits, like 1 and 2 makes 3, 1 and 5 makes 6, 1 and 8 makes 9, the pattern 3, 6, 9 is there for all numbers that are divisible by 3. And so if you add the digits until you get to one number, and it's 3, 6, or 9, then it's divisible by 3. If it's a 3, 6, or 9, and the number is even, then it will also divide by 6. And if you add the digits together and you get 9, then it will divide by 9. Multiplication square has lots of uses. You can use it for multiplication, of course, and all you do then is look at the top number, and there's to the left, you look at the number that you want to multiply. So we wanted to multiply 6 times 4. You look at 6 on the top column. You look at 4 on the left-hand side, and where they meet, there's your answer. Similarly for division, if you want 24 divided by 6, then you go down the 6th column, because that's what you're dividing by. You go down till you get to 24. Then you work along to your left-hand side, and that gives you the answer. So that's multiplication and division. But it also contains your square numbers, and it also contains equal fractions. So let's have a quick look at those. If you look at the diagonal from 1 to 100, the diagonal there is your diagonal of square numbers. And if you want to use it for equal fractions, which you might for GCSE, for instance, if you look at the top line on the second line, if you look at 1 over 2, it's equal to 2 over 4, is equal to 3 over 6, is equal to 4 over 8, etc. Or if you want 2 thirds, you've got 2 and 3, you can do 2 thirds is the same as 4, 6, 6 minus 8 twelfths. Or you could do it as 1 quarter, do the 1 on the 4 column, is 2 eighths, 3 twelfths, and so on. So it's a really useful square for all sorts of things, even up to quite high level of work. So, that was multiplication. Time is another particular problem for people who are dyslexic. A clock is quite easy, because the hour hand is actually on a number, and it actually says what it is. So if, for instance, we were talking about 5 o'clock, the hour hand would point to 5, and o'clock would actually point to 12. But as soon as we get to half and quarter past, of course, we're saying it the other way around. So if I've got quarter past 5, for instance, I'm saying the hour hand second, not first. But in digital time, I would have it written first, 5:15. And that change of position often confuses dyslexics. They need to be very sure about where the hour hand is and where the minute hand is. The other problem, of course, is that confuses them is when you get to, say, quarter past 5, the hour hand is no longer pointing at an hour. It's pointing between hours. And so the o'clock time is the only time it's actually pointing directly at a number. And I point out as well that the hour hand moves and how the hour hand moves so that they know where it is. This, before they can do half and quarters, of course, they need to understand the fractions. So unless they understand where half is, or they understand what a quarter is, they really can't understand what these mean. So it's very important that they've done lots of work on fractions for half and quarter before these begin. I always teach o'clock and then half past, make sure they thoroughly understand both of those before I would then do quarter past, and then once I've done that, I will link to quarter to. Then we go to 5 minutes past. There's only 5 past and 10 past and 20 past and 25 past that I find I need to teach, because then I say on the other side it's symmetrical. So we learn 5 past and 5 to at the same time, and we learn 10 past and 10 to at the same time, 20 past 22 and 25 past and 25 to. And so they literally only learn in half the clock and just have to flip it from the past and to two. But again, they have to know which way around the hands are moving, and they have to know when they're coming past a number and when they're going towards a number. It's not easily taught. It does take a lot of time, but the symmetry does seem to work. Digital time is generally not too difficult, because the hour hand always stays at the beginning. And when it comes to 24-hour clock, just say that you add 12 on or take 12 off to find out what the time is. Lovely tale about digital time. I had one pupil who did tell me that I didn't need to worry about analog time anymore because it was being switched off. And it took me a few minutes to realise that he wasn't actually talking about time at all. He was talking about the TV, and he discovered that the analog was being switched off, and he did think it was time. So he was very disappointed when I told him that unfortunately he was still going to have to learn the analog time. Days of the week are a problem for dyslexic pupils often. They need to learn them and they need to be able to sequence them. Often they don't know what day of the week they're in and they haven't got a clue what tomorrow is. So that needs lots of work as well. And then the fact that when I get to tomorrow, it's today, confuses them. And how can today be yesterday, tomorrow? So vocabulary is very difficult for time. Months of the year are also difficult, and actually they don't always relate it to events around them. I remember one pupil who told me that he'd spent a lovely time in Australia, seen in the new year, lots of fireworks, Canberra Harbour, and I was very envious. And then I said to him, the first week back in January, I said, now be careful of the date. I know, he said, it's January, no worries. And then when he wrote the year, he wrote the wrong year. I said to him, the year has changed. And he said, oh, when did that happen? So we then had to explain that new year was actually changing the year and we were going to have a new year. So he'd had all those celebrations and hadn't really understood why they were happening. Now we're going to go to shopping. Anybody who's been to one of my talks knows that I go to my talks generally with a huge bag of shopping, because I think there's huge potential in shopping. If you look at most of the shopping, it's really useful for looking at 3D shape. I came to this conclusion one day when I thought, well, most children know square, rectangle, circle and triangle. So why don't they know cube and cuboid and sphere and cone? And then I realised it was because we really don't use the names. Even parents look at things, a cylinder, and say it's a circle. So I thought if you use shopping, you could really do lots on 3D shapes, because you can look at different size cylinders, you can see how they always have two circular faces and a rectangular one, but they can look very different. Similarly with cuboids and packages, they can always look very different, but they are actually similar shapes. And useful for tessellation. And if you don't know what tessellation is, this is where all the shapes will fit together without any gaps. So you can do this great with cuboids and cubes, but you can't actually do it for cylinders because there are always gaps. Useful for capacity and weight as well. because you can actually look at different packages. You can see how you can work from a kilogram down to 500 grams, down to 250 grams. You can try adding different packet weights together. They can see that some packets are heavy even when they're small, and some big packets are quite light. And you can see that, you know, if you've got a 300 milliliter bottle of water, that sometimes they all look different sizes. So it's quite useful for all sorts of things, as well as being useful for money, of course. Data handling. I think this is also good if you can actually generate your own data. I think I like to use Dice to create different things. So we might set up a tally chart. I might have my 1 to 6s. I might throw my dice a lot, and we'll tally in all the numbers, and then we'll work out what I would have scored. And this then helps with the older ones, who will actually see that, yes, I have to multiply the two numbers together to actually get my function at the end. And counters are really useful for doing bar graphs. Smarties make them even more fun, particularly because you can eat them afterwards and you've got lots of colours there, which is really quite useful. So you can create your own tables and charts, and it means that they've got to draw their own axes in, and they've got to work out what their scales might be, and sometimes it might be convenient to work in ones, sometimes they might have to work in twos. They might decide to do their own pictograms, where they actually use a different picture that will represent more than one, and so they get used to seeing these before they're actually presented with them as problems. Mode, mean, median, and the range are words that they have to understand within KeyStage 2, but often words that get very mixed up in by dyslexic pupils. So we usually work on the fact that mode is the most, because it sounds alike. Median sounds like middle, so that's the one that's in the middle, but you've got to put them in order first. And mean is the really mean one, because you've got to add them all up and divide by a number, and that makes it really tricky. And the range is just from the beginning to the end and the difference between them. Now, somebody always asks me about word problems, because these are particularly tricky for dyslexic pupils, because they can't read the words for a start. Then they have to work out the problem, and they can't decide what they're going to do. So I decided that maybe we don't work from the right way around. We actually don't give them an example of what to do. So word problems are needed for all sections of maths, so that maths can be applied. And they really do need to be able to use all that mathematical knowledge in real life situations. But most of them have faced those real life situations first, and the maths comes later. So word problems shouldn't really be difficult. But can your pupils actually create their own problems? I find that this is when I can really tell whether my pupils can actually do well or not. If they can't create their own problems, then how do I know that they can actually understand the words? For instance, they might do an addition problem, and they might use multiplication, or they might have a multiplication problem and do an addition. So I use this problem board. Now, here you can see we've got a number, which is 4 plus 6 equals 10. That can be any number you like. So you might have it as 3 times 5 equals 15. You might have it as 4 plus x equals 7. You can use it in any kind of number you like. You can use this for algebra as well. Then I use the words, because I find if they write the words regularly, then they can read them. Equals is a particularly hard word to spell, but if they write it often enough, then they can remember how to spell it, and also so they can see it written, they know what it means. And that can happen for all kinds of different words. Multiply, you can use total, you can use all the different vocabulary that might be difficult and you want them to use. then they have to create a problem. So here it's very simple. I had 4 sweets and I found 6 more. You'll certainly find what your pupils really enjoy. They like to do things like, certainly when I teach lots of boys, I find myself with lots of soldiers and get more soldiers. Excuse me. Or if we're doing subtraction, we have soldiers and then we have a lot of soldiers being killed off. And then they can do a picture to go with it. Now, this is the way around I start. I start off with the number and then we write the words. Then we think of a problem and then we write a picture. But there's no reason why I can't put words in first and then say, now write the number and now write the problem and the picture. Or say, now I have a problem. What are the numbers? What are the words? What is the picture? And one of the things that I've discovered over time is that if you give dyslexic pupils a word problem, they then like to draw a picture to go with it first, and then they can find the number. So it's as if they need that extra boost to actually visualize the work before they go to the number. And so I come to my conclusion, really. I hope we've looked at how dyslexia might affect maths, albeit quite superficially, really, and briefly touched on dyscalculia and how that might or might not be a problem for some pupils, but very few, I think, will actually suffer from dyscalculia, and they will have particular numerical problems. And then I hope we've come up with some, what I hope are useful practical suggestions for number, type, for measures, for data handling, and for word problems.